please stand to your feet for a short moment. And let's lift our hands. I like that song you were singing earlier. You are holy. Holy. It's a simple song. Everyone can sing it. Lord, there is none like you. Everybody here, lift your hands, close your eyes and sing, you are holy. Holy. You are holy. Glory to you.
Glory to you, our Lord.
Let's sing it again. You are holy. Come on, church, lift your hands. Let's sing it. You are holy. It's worth singing to him. Lord, there is none like you.
None like you.
You are holy, Jesus.
You are holy,
Jesus. Oh, I love you, Lord.
Glory to you, alone.
Come on, let's sing. I'll sing your praises forever. Favorite part, here in your courts when I'm close.
Here in your courts when I'm close to your throne.
I find where I belong.
I find where I belong.
Come on, let's sing it again. I'll sing your praises forever.
I'll sing your praises forever.
Deeper in love with you. Courts when I'm close to your throne.
Here in your courts where I'm close to your throne. I found where I belong.
I'll sing your praises forever. Come on, church, let me hear you say, deeper in love with you.
Deeper in love.
Lift your hands. Everybody in church, lift your hands. Lift up your hands. Learn how to worship the Lord. Lift your hands and sing, here in your courts.
Here in your courts, where I'm close to your throne.
Sing, I find where I belong.
I find where I belong.
The whole church, one more time. I'll sing your praises forever.
I'll sing your praises forever.
It's a simple song. Everybody can sing it. Deeper in love with you.
Deeper in love with you.
Now everybody sing, here in your courts when I'm close to your throne.
Here in your courts where I'm close to your throne.
I find where I belong.
I find where I belong.
And as the deep pants and fall, the waters of my soul longeth after thee. Come on, everybody, close your eyes and sing, you alone.
You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Come on, let's sing it again. As the deer pants for the water.
As the deer pant and fall, the waters, so my soul longeth after thee.
You alone, you alone, you alone.
You alone.
You alone are my hunger. You alone are my desire. You alone are my thirst. You are all I want. You are all I desire. I long to worship you. I long to be in your presence. Come on, let's sing. You alone.
My strength, my shield.
You alone.
To you alone.
You make my strength. My strength.
You alone are my
strength.
You alone are my
strength.
You alone are my strength.
Come on, church. more time. You alone.
You are my strength.
He's perfect in my weakness. You alone. You make my spirit yield. Make my spirit yield. Let your presence fill this place. My spirit, you alone at my house. I am alone. Every time that we are gathered together in His name. Also in power and in strength. So let us continually offer the sacrifice to Him, for it is good to sing praises to our God. Let's sing it one more time. Every time we are gathered, and every time we are God, together in His name, together in His name. There He is also in power, in strength. I believe the Lord is here. So let us continually offer our sacrifice to Him, for it is good to sing praises to our God. Come on, He inhabits the praises. For you inhabit the praises of your people. And let our praises, so let our praise be sweet incense unto you. And the lifting of our hands, and let the lifting of our hands be as the evening sacrifice. Lord, we love you. Lord, we love you. Oh, Lord, we love you. He inhabits.
For you inhabit the praises of your people.
So let our praise.
So let our praise be sweet incense unto you.
And let the lifting of our hands.
And let the lifting of our hands.
To be in your presence.
And I long to be in your presence. My soul will wait on you.
Father, draw me. Father, draw me near. Draw me nearer. Draw me nearer. Oh, to the beauty of your home. Sing, I will wait for you.
I will wait on you.
Almighty God.
Almighty God.
In the beauty of your holiness.
In the beauty of your holiness.
I will worship you.
I will worship you.
Almighty God.
Your people pray.
nobody here who is above singing.
You will hear from heaven. You will send your mercy.
Touch us.
Touch us with your healing.
Hey. Let's sing it again. Lord, you have told us. Church, everybody sing it. Lord, you have told us.
You have.
Everybody can learn and sing this song.
Lord, you have promised.
If your people,
if your people could pray.
Now tell the Lord, you will hear from heaven.
You will hear from heaven.
Oh, yes.
And you will send your mercy.
Touch us with your strong healing hand. God is touching you today. God's hand is touching you today.
So we're calling out to you.
We're crying out to you.
Calling out to you.
Forgive us of our sins. Heal our land.
As we seek your holy face.
As we seek your holy face.
Turn.
We turn from all our wicked ways.
And from heaven in the night.
As we pray.
Let's sing it again. Seek your holy face.
As we seek your holy face,
we turn
from all our wicked ways.
Hear from heaven even now.
One more time. We're calling out to you.
So we're calling out to you.
Lord, crying out to you.
We are worshiping, church. Lift your hands and sing it.
As we seek, we turn from all. Hear from heaven even now as we pray. Hear from heaven even now.
Church is crying out to you, Lord. Our church is lifting our hands. We're lifting our hearts. Forgive us of our sins and touch our land. Touch our church. Touch our lives. As we seek your holy face, as we seek your precious presence, we turn from our wicked ways. We turn from the old man and we put on Christ. Jesus.
As we worship you, let all the nations come and see how the mercy we've received from you can set them free.
As we worship you,
as we worship you, let all this joy that fills our hearts bring a home and a home who stray so far. As we bow
in adoration
and we stand in reverence,
show your majesty and love.
Yes, let your anointing fall.
As we declare your name, Lord Jesus, as the only
the power of your salvation
fill this heart, we pray.
As we bow,
as
as we bow in adoration and we stand in reverent awe. Show your majesty and glory. Let your anointing fall as we declare your name as the only name,
as the only.
Father, we thank you. Thank you for your presence. You are so real. You are so real. As we come to sit at your feet this afternoon, we pray for your presence. We bow in adoration and we stand in reverent awe. Show your majesty, show your glory, and let your anointing fall. Let your Holy Spirit fill this place. Speak to each of us, Lord. Help us to have an encounter with you. Holy Spirit, manifest yourself. Show your face. Help us to know you and find you. I pray for our sins, Lord. I ask for your blood to wash each and every one of us. Help us to come before you, to hear from you, and to receive from you. Thank you for this wonderful church. Thank you for the wonderful anointing that you sent to us through our prophet. Thank you for the grace of God that is with us, even now. For even now he works. Even now he moves. Even now he speaks. I thank you. Help us to go home better than we came. Help us to go home better than we came. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Oh, come on, put your hands together for the Lord. You may be seated. What a blessing. I bring you greetings from our prophet. And I spoke to him last night, and as usual, he was talking about the church, and I know his heart is with us. He can't be here today, but very, 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 very soon, he'll be back with us. Amen. So make sure that you are here over in a few weeks, I believe. He'll be back with us, and I know the Lord is blessing us. Amen. Amen or no amen. Do you already feel blessed by the presence of God? As we worship you, let all the nations come and see how the mercy we've received from you can set them free. As we worship you, let all this joy that fills our hearts bring a hunger and a hope to those who stray so far. This is my favorite part. As we bow in adoration and we stand in reverent awe, show your majesty and glory. Let your anointing fall. As we declare your name, Lord Jesus, as the only name who saves, may the power of your salvation fill each heart, we pray. As we worship. Amen. I want to share with us from our prophet's book, Read Your Bible, Pray Every Day. read your Bible, pray every day. Amen. I believe that it's a powerful book. I believe you should get it. But I'm sharing from the half, which is pray every day. The half of the book is read your Bible. And the second half of the book is what? Pray every day. We used to sing that song. Read your Bible, pray every day, pray every day, pray every day. Read 1 Thessalonians 5:17. Pray every day if you want to. And today, I'm on chapter 9, why people don't pray every day. All right? Because how many of you know prayer is a good thing? Prayer is the key. Prayer is the key. Prayer is the master key. Jesus started with prayer and ended with prayer. Prayer is the master key. Wow. We must wait, wait on the Lord. We must wait, wait on the Lord. Learn our lessons well. In His timing, He will tell where to go, what to do. These are prayer songs. What to say. And then we have, come away, come away. Come and spend some time with me. Come away. Let your heart and mind be filled. And let your empty cup be filled. Come and spend some time with me. Come away. Isn't it beautiful? Now, there's a reason we don't pray every day. But the Bible says pray without ceasing. And this thought from Paul is that a Christian is supposed to be praying constantly and every day. And the prayer that does not happen every day is not a prayer that can sustain a Christian life. And I think as a Christian, you have to recognize that if your life is without daily prayer, you are not a successful Christian, and your walk with God cannot be sustained. Amen. And I believe the Lord wants us to come to Him daily and to seek Him daily and to be close to Him daily. No matter who you are, there's no, you like prophet says, you cannot graduate above prayer. You cannot reach the point in your walk with God where you are above daily prayer with the Lord. And the Bible tells us, pray without ceasing. Amen. Proverbs chapter 8 verse 34 tells us, blessed is the man that heareth me, watching daily at my gates and waiting at the post of my door. Amen. Amen. And I believe that perhaps, can I come down? Perhaps the reason why in our church and in most churches, or at least the ones I know, you can have people who go to church, have a pastor, join the choir, and be part of the house of God, but they don't really change. I would say that it's because salvation doesn't change you. When you are saved, the Bible says you become a new man. But your body is still the same. Your mind is still the same. Your flesh still has the same needs. It still has the same desires. If you come for a crusade and the Holy Spirit touches your heart to come forward to give your life to Him, and before you came forward, you were hungry. When you finish the crusade, you are still hungry after you give your life to Christ. That alone should show you that your flesh is still the same. If your favorite food was jollof before you gave your life to Christ, after you give your life to Christ, the food you want to eat doesn't change. So you may be a Christian, and I'm answering a question for some people today, that the reason why people don't change is because without a life of prayer, you yourself don't ever really change, although you are saved and although you are a Christian. So you find the most horrible people in church. You find the most unforgiving people sitting in church. You find the most deceptive, the people who have lied to you the most, if you've been in church for a few years, the people who have lied to you the most, or I would even say that the most creative of lies. No, so listen, you can be here, you can be an usher, you can be in security, you can be in, you can be a pastor, but you don't actually change if you don't learn daily to spend. There's nobody here who is above daily prayer with the Lord. And that's why we don't actually, how we are doesn't change. Yesterday somebody told me, I don't feel like being in the house with my mother. I feel like going to find my own place. This is somebody in the Greater Love Gospel Choir singing. Today she was singing right by my side. I was watching her. You are, she's listening, she's in church today. It's not a mysterious person. You were there, oh Lord. She's probably looking at me now. Your presence, Lord. That is what I need. But the person hasn't changed. So, what changes a person? What alters a person? What changes how you are? It's from a life of prayer. That is all. There's nothing about coming to church that can change you. You can keep on coming and coming until, why do I say that? Because, you know, the Bible says in Isaiah 64 verse 7, it says, there's none that stirreth up himself. God was speaking about prayer. There's none that calleth upon thy name and stirreth up himself to take hold of you. This is talking about prayer. For thou hast hid thy face from us and consumed us because of our iniquities. Then verse 8, he says, we are the clay. You see, your life is clay. And in prayer, when you stir yourself up to take hold of God, your vessel, your yourself, is put into the hands of the potter. Oh, I'm so blessed by what I'm saying. And as every day at 4 a.m., you wake up from your bed and you lift up your hands and say, and we stand in reverent awe. Show your majesty and glory. Not in church. Not in church, talking about at home. In Psalm 63, David says, my heart and my soul, my flesh longs for you in a dry and a thirsty land where no water is. Then in verse 2, he says, to see your power and your glory as I saw it in the sanctuary. So what you saw in the sanctuary today, whatever you experience from prayer to prayer, you are supposed to have a desire to see it at home as you saw it in church. If you don't have that, you will never change. That's all. If you are watching me now and you go to this church and you don't pray every day, your Christianity will never have an impact on your life. You will stay the same. If you don't, and I'm not talking about going to pray for 2 days and come back. That's also powerful. We may come to that. But I'm talking about praying. Blessed is the man watching daily. Now, I'm saying the Bible is telling us that we are the clay, and as we stir ourselves up to seek him, we actually, in Jeremiah 18, we go down to the potter's house. And we put him in our hand. We put ourselves in his hands. And the Bible says, and the clay was mud. And the potter started to work on the clay. So every morning, God is on Wednesday, he works on you. On Thursday, he works on you. On Friday. So if you never pray, you're never being worked on. And I'm telling you, no one else can change you but God. My iPad screen cracked once. My iPad, the big one too. So the crack was terrible. So somebody told me of a place called Tiptoe Lane at Circle. So I took my iPad. You see, the word potter that is used, Jeremiah 18, is used in Isaiah 64. That word potter is the same word that's used in Genesis when it says, and God formed man. That word formed man is pottery. The exact same word, exactly the same word. So when God was making you, he is the manufacturer. Okay, but after he made you, then you went to spoil certain things witches. So when I took my iPad to tip tolling and it came back, it was working, but everything was yellow.
Come on.
My Bible was yellow. Any video I watch is yellow. My books were yellow. Everything was yellow. So somebody told me I should give him the iPad. He'll sort it out. He took it. I thought he's stolen it because for 6 weeks, somebody in this church took my iPad. So he'll sort it out. So I thought by now it's gone. So after 6 weeks, he usually committed to the Lord. So I was there and the person brought it back to me after 6 weeks. Perfect. Up till today, perfect. What happened? He sent it to America, where the people who manufactured the iPad are. And the one, not tiptoe, the one who knows how to make it is the one who knows how to fix it. Your life cannot be fixed by anyone you know, any pastor, any shepherd, any parent. Your life cannot be fixed by the police. Your life cannot be fixed by the government of Ghana. Cannot be fixed by any teacher or any educational service. Blessed is the man who comes before me daily. He puts his life into my hands and I can work on him and I can change him. I can change him. That's where we are changed. We are only changed when we are prayerful. I'm telling you. Look, when I came into full-time ministry, somebody gave me advice. A bishop gave me advice. He told me, the place you can be unspiritual is full-time ministry. You'll be so busy that you don't have time to be alone with the Lord. That's where we are changed. You see, that's why you see people come into church, but nothing is changing. Like you are able to come to church and go to a nightclub. Like you're able to close an all-night prayer meeting and from there you go to a nightclub. How do you do it? It's all from a lack of prayer. Because what there's no change. And what brings the fear of God is prayer. Job 15 verse 4 says, thou casteth off fear. I wish somebody had a jacket. Thou casteth, give me a cloth on. Thou casteth off fear and restrainest prayer before God. Thank you so much. People who don't pray, this is the fear of God. The word cast off is speaking of like a jacket. Put it behind you. Hey, be careful. This is the fear of God. This is the fear of God. I can't because I'm afraid. I can't talk about that because I'm afraid of God. I can't comment on that issue because I'm afraid of God. I can't insult that man because he's a man of God. I'm afraid of him. I can't lie. I'm sorry. I can't tell a lie. I can't join you. I'm sorry. I can't sign that check. I can't join. I can't agree to that contract because I'm scared of God. So how does it happen that you have a dancing star who is in church, comes to church every week, and is able to live a complete life of sin without ever feeling bad, ever having any form of conscience attack or anything and be in church? I'm giving you the answer. You cast off. You remove the fear of God from your life when you restrain prayer before God. That's why people are not scared anymore. Are not afraid anymore. If you want to have the fear of God in your life, that there are certain things I can't do. So one day somebody saw some so-called Christian leaders misbehaving. And he asked the question, do they pray? Do they have any cause? As soon as you step into the presence of God, you start thinking of your sin. Yeah, Isaiah was a bold prophet until he saw the Lord. Then immediately he starts saying, I'm unclean. My lips are unclean. I dwell amongst unclean people. The first thing is, what I've said was wrong. Unclean lips. The first thing is, what you even say. And so if you don't learn how to pray every day, that's I'm talking about changes. See, he's never developed the fear of God. He used to lie, he's still lying. He used to smoke, he's still smoking. Then you make it look as if some things can't go. You don't pray daily. You don't pray daily. So you cast off the fear of God. You throw it away. And you move on with life because you don't pray. Oh, yes. That's why people don't change. That's why somebody can come to church. See, have you noticed people who don't enjoy God? Like, they are with us right here. And you, Bishop Iceberg, may have a wonderful revelation from Jeremiah. Yes. And then you'll be sharing with two people and they are very blessed. You know that the Lord himself is even blessed by revelation. Yeah, in Malachi chapter 4, the Bible says, those who fear the Lord speak often to one another. And a book of remembrance was open, and the Lord was writing down everything that the people were saying. He was, oh, wow, that's powerful. And then God was writing it down. Yeah, it's in Malachi 4. It's right there. If she finds it, if she's working today. 3, 3:17. You can have Malachi 3:17. Sorry, not 4. 3:17. Hello, if you don't mind. Good. Somewhere here. 18. Try 18. Oh, hello. Up there. 18. Next. Click next. Press the arrow. Press the arrow next. Okay. It's okay. Anyway. Then he says, then Isaac is sharing the, and the people are blessed. Wow. Hey, shh. You see, like, why are you standing? Some people don't stand. No, no, don't stand. Don't stand. I'm not saying that. I mean, nobody stands always. That's also not real. But I'm saying that why is that, like, when a prophet is preaching, like, you are never blessed. Like what he said from Judges 6. It doesn't affect you that. I mean, like, you things don't bless you. Uh-huh. So that people don't enjoy God. They always think about the service is long. And I'm saying, like, Mr. Isaac will share from Jeremiah. Something from Malachi. You see that when somebody else comes to join, then he starts talking about the Ukraine war. Because it's like, no, you know what I'm talking about, right? Like, it's like this person, I cannot share the word, the Holy Spirit, the presence of God, what the Lord told me. It's like, have you met somebody that you're inviting people for an all night? When you see her, how she is, you just feel like, no, the all night is not part. All that one too is from a lack of prayer. Job 27:10 says that. Will he always pray to him? Will he always delight in the Almighty? Will he always delight in the Almighty? Will he always pray to him? So people who pray to God, they delight in God. Like they enjoy God. They like church service. They like worship. You see, why is it that nothing ever moves you? Like there's no song that can move you. Today I was in the office and I heard them singing the song and I came outside. I heard them singing, calling out to you. And it, something touched me. Why is it that nothing ever touches you? And I was sure, as I was worshiping, I don't know what happened. I turned around. I think I look at the screen. I saw some people sitting down. I'm showing you why they restrain themselves from prayer. Will he always delight in the Almighty? Will he always pray to him? They don't enjoy God. So it's always a struggle. They don't like that. Let's share a verse. Or have you heard this message? Very powerful. They don't like such things. They don't enjoy all nights. They don't enjoy prayer meetings. They don't enjoy conventions. They don't enjoy anything. They just want us to close. What time does your church close? That's all. They are not blessed by any revelation, nothing. Last week, Sunday, I was in prophet's office. And praise and worship was going on. And he was coming out. He was about to come out of the office. And when he got to the door, I think Pastor Jerome lifted a song. I think it was calling out to you. As soon as he lifted the song, prophet's about to open the door. He left the door. And he lifted, was holding his iPad just like this. And he lifted up both his hands like this. And he said, then he just started to sing. And he said, this song is so powerful. It's so anointed. That's what he says. This song is so anointed. How come you never sense that there's an anointing? What I'm talking about is delighting. Put it up again. Job 27:10. Will he delight himself in the Almighty? Will he always call upon God? Will he delight? So if you're in the church and all these years you don't like God, the ecstasy of serving God is found in prayer. The greatest joy is found in prayer. And when you don't pray, every day you start to change. You become worse. You become more into the flesh, more into yourself and how you are. And that's why you can be here for many, many, many years. We have now been in this building for 6 years. Yeah, getting to 7. 6 years of worshiping in this mountain. What has it done for you? Still the same. Your mother used to say you are stubborn. She's still saying you are stubborn and you still don't agree. Which further proves the point. You are now very stubborn. You had a boyfriend then. You've only changed the boyfriend, but you still maintain the boyfriend. You are able to smoke, drink, go to nightclub, do everything. You are okay with everything. You don't pray. That's why you've not changed. You know, the Bible says, Psalm 10:4, it says, the wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in his thoughts. Yes. You don't have the presence of God in your consciousness as you live through life because you don't seek after God. So as you go through your day, God is not, he's not present in your consciousness. The best example, and I know I've told you this story before, but I'll tell you again. The best explanation I've ever heard about this, about seeking God and God being your thought, is from Dr. Yonggi Cho. I've told you before, but I know, but pretend so that I'll tell you again. Dr. Yonggi Cho, do you want to sit down or you want to sit down? You can sit down. Oh, sit down. I'm talking to you. You can sit down, because if you stand, we've not started point one. So, are you there? Going home? Are you interested in what I'm saying today? Dr. Yonggi Cho says that. He's a Korean, okay? Korea is a country in Southeast Asia. God bless you. Now, in Korea, they speak what? Korean. Korean, in case you didn't know. They speak what? Korean. So he said that. He felt that God wanted him to save souls in America and souls in Japan. So he decided that he wants to learn English so that he can communicate in English and preach to American churches and pastors. Are you listening?
Yeah.
Oh, are you interested in my story?
Yeah.
So he told his wife, you can only speak to me in English. So it wasn't easy at all. Like if she has something to say, then she has to now go and find the dictionary and figure out what to say. Then he told all his office staff, only speak to me in English. Then he himself, he said he used to talk to himself in English and prepare his sermons in English by force, to force him to learn how to speak in English so that he could reach the English-speaking people. Then he did the same thing with Japanese. It wouldn't be easy to be in his office, mom, honestly. Just be changing the languages. So anyone come, please, somebody needs to, no. Japanese, yes, today is Japanese. Then you have to now go and figure out and come and say. So everybody around him was forced to speak English. Then he said, to his surprise, as he drove through, there's feedback somewhere. As he drove through the city of Seoul, okay, to his surprise, he started to notice English signboards. Oh. Then he said, he started to notice English actors. He started to know about Hollywood. Then he said he started to discover about England, the Queen, the Prime Minister of England, the President of America. Because he was speaking English, every time he would be in a lounge and what was on TV was BBC or CNN, he started to understand what they were talking about and the faces and the people. He said he became so aware of the English world, which before, not that he traveled there, but in his own country and his own world, because he spoke English, he said he suddenly realized all the English signboards that are littered all over Seoul in Korea. He started to understand and know people and know things. Then he said, this is exactly how I feel when I speak in tongues. He said, when I speak in the language of heaven and the language of the spirit, I become aware of what's going on in the spirit. I become aware of angels. I become aware of what God is doing. I become more, as I walk through, not that we go to heaven, but as you walk through Accra, you become more aware of the presence of the Holy Spirit and what God is doing and what God is in all your thoughts. God is in all your thoughts. That's why we forget God from Sunday to Saturday, because we don't pray. When you seek after God, God is in your thoughts. God is in your mind at work. God is in your mind at school. God is always with you. God always has something to say. You will notice the signboards that God has. You will notice his servants. You will notice his people. You will notice his government. You will notice his word. You will notice him moving when you speak in tongues. Oh, yes. When you don't speak in tongues, you don't pray. I don't care who you are. Hey. Today, dear, let me feel free. I don't care who you are, what title you have, who you are, who you tell, how long you've been here, whether you are the captain of this, whether you are the head of wherever, whatever you do in this church. If you don't pray every day, you'll never change. Your life will stay the same until the end. It will never change. You will never see God moving in your life. You'll never experience the wonders of God if you don't pray. Oh yes, you know, everything will be normal. You always hear of testimonies and never hear them in your life. You'll be hearing from the stage, and you'll never hear them in your life, because signs and wonders are a product of prayer. Isaiah 8:17 says, famous verse, Isaiah 8:17. I will wait upon the Lord that hideth his face from the house of Jacob, and I will look for him. Next verse, behold, I and my children are for signs and wonders. Signs and wonders come to people who pray. Yes, that's why your life is ordinary. Everything is ordinary. Everything follows the logical line of continuation. There's no interruption from the Holy Spirit. There's no miracles, no wonders, nothing supernatural. So I want you to pray every day. But now the question is, why don't people pray every day? If it's so powerful and so important to pray, why don't people pray every day? And the reasons are four. You know, it's such a powerful chapter in the book, and I want all of you to read it. There are only four reasons why, every, and it happens to all of us, including me. And the first reason I'm going to give you today is people don't pray every day because they have to attend to many other duties of life during the day. Many duties. How many of you are busy? How many of you have things to do tomorrow? How many of you have things to do tonight? What about on Wednesday? Are you free on Thursday? That's why we don't pray. Sometimes even busyness in church can make you not pray. But the solution to that problem is praying in the night. Because in the night, only witches and prayer warriors are working in the night. Luke 10:38. Very quickly. Oh, I'm blessed already. Now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. 39. And she had a sister called Mary. Called what? Which also sat where? Now, Jesus' feet is the greatest place you can be. Being at Jesus' feet every morning is the place of prayer. That's why we say, down at your feet, oh Lord, is the most high place. In church we sing, everybody's singing. In your presence, Lord, I seek your face. It's not easy here. I seek your face. Why? What happens at his feet? There is no higher calling. There's no higher calling than the call to prayer. Greater honor than to bow and kneel. Come on, pick it up. I can't hear. I'm amazed at your glory. Come on. Embrace by your mercy, oh Lord. I live to worship you. So this is where Mary was. She was down at his feet. Oh Lord. I see somebody tomorrow morning at the highest place, at the feet of Jesus, in your presence. Jesus, Lord. I seek your face. I seek your. Come on, I seek your face. I seek your face. There's no higher calling. There is no higher calling. There's no greater honor than to bow and kneel before your throne. I see somebody on Tuesday morning at the feet of Jesus. I see somebody, I don't know who it is, for the first time, a weed smoker down at his feet. There's no higher calling. There's no higher calling than the call to prayer. There's no higher, the calling to be a pastor is not as high as the calling to be at the feet of Jesus. There's no higher, there's no greater honor. Oh yes. It's greater. It's greater now. Then look at what happened. She heard his word, because in his presence you hear from him. That's communion. Talk to me, I talk to you. Speak to me, I speak to you. Call unto me, I'll answer you, Jeremiah said. So she was talking to Jesus. Then Martha. Now, Martha was cumbered about with much serving. Martha was serving the Lord, but not at his feet. Oh. Martha was a servant of the Lord. Are you a servant of the Lord? I want to tell you that there's no higher calling. There is no greater honor. I accept that being a pastor is an honor, because no one takes this honor on himself. But there's a higher honor, which is the honor of being at the feet of Jesus. Oh yeah, it's a great honor. I am amazed at your glory and grace, by your mercy, oh Lord. Ah yes, I live to worship you. Is your service to God cumbering you from being at his feet? Then she came to him and said, Lord, don't you care that now? By the way, let me just tell you what my pastor, Bishop Richard, taught me. He taught me that we marry Martha. Because there's no food at Jesus' feet. Yeah, he said that we marry Martha and we talk to her that she should be spiritual, but Mary, anyway, that's just by the way, in case somebody wants to know. Now, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to serve alone? You see, you need someone to serve you at home. You don't need prayer. I mean, it's good to pray, but you understand what I'm saying? Yeah, we need something to you. Anyway, bid her therefore that she help me. Then Jesus explained what it means to be at his feet, what it means to pray every day, what the three descriptions of Jesus of your daily and personal prayer time. He said, Jesus said, Martha, you are worried about many things, your children, your job, your house, your church, your bacenta, your choir, your days, your friends, your family, your mother, your this. You are worried about many things, okay? But one thing is needful. The first thing she said, Jesus said, sorry, was that the prayer at his feet, iceberg, is what you need. You don't need the singing on stage. No. You don't need that one. You don't need the ushering that you are doing. It is a good benefit, but it's not what you need. What you need is prayer. It's not your church attendance. It's very good, very important. But what you need, maybe nobody has told you before, when you give your life to Christ, what you need, what is needful, is to be at his feet. What you need, my friends, what you need is a need. I had COVID. You two, you've had it before, clear off. I had COVID some months ago. I couldn't come to church, couldn't go out, and I kept testing. I wanted to be free. So I kept on going. And when I go, 3 times positive. Every 3 days, I was checking again. I wanted to be free. So I called my doctor. I have a very good doctor. I called her. Only that she likes injections too much. When I called her, she asked me, what am I taking? I said, I'm taking this. Then I told her that. She told me something I'll never forget. She said that. I said, I'm increasing the vitamin C. I was increasing everything. Then she told me, no. All that is not going to help. You know, art students, you feel that the more the merrier. You get it? So I said, I'm increasing. Then she told me that, no. What if there's something that you should increase? What actually kills the thing? It's zinc. So you take a lot of things, but one thing is needed. The word is need. I know we come to church. I know we were. I was negative within 2 days. Hey, the zinc that I took at the point, I even vomited the zinc. I took the zinc. I understood what is needful. I know that preach. I know that you pray. Maybe you even mow grass for the church. Maybe you wipe. Maybe you bus every Sunday. Thank you. All those things are powerful. But what you need. I'm blessed by this. What you need, one thing is needful. You need it. You can't do without it. You can't survive without it. You can't be a Christian without it. You can't do without it. You need it. Then you're just beginning. Then number two, it's the good part. Have you eaten meat pie before?
Yes, please.
The one which the meat is only in the middle. All the other one is powerful, but we are all always heading towards the... I'll tell you for free. I'll tell you. I'll dash it to you. I enjoy preaching. Oh, yes. I enjoy shepherding. It's exciting. Yes, sheep and goats. Especially the nimble ones. When they are jumping on the mountains and you're watching them. I love it and I enjoy it. I really enjoy it. I also enjoy... being in ministry with my father. I enjoy it when he calls me to ask me something about the church. I feel like Jesus Christ. Yes, because he and his father created the world. So I enjoy. I can't lie to you. I want to be honest with you. These are the joys. I enjoy all of these things in the ministry. Another thing I enjoy listening to prophet preach at home, even more than here. Yeah, I'm telling you what I like. The part I can tell you what I don't like. Yeah, one thing I don't like all night. I can't. It's only me. Why are you saying, hey, it's only me? Do you like it? Yeah. I do it a lot. I do a lot of honor, but I don't like it. You come, the whole church has come, we're all sweating. And you know, last time we had a 24-hour prayer meeting to my shop. I saw a lot of Glovo cars arriving, Yango, a lot of deliveries. And I said, wow, as we are praying. I found out after. Yeah, just members, they're wonderful. I enjoy all of these things, but the good part... I can't lie to you, the good part of the ministry, I tell you, it's not in organizing something or doing something or preaching at a service or preaching at a crusade. I'm telling you, I'm telling you, this is nice. It's nice preaching, it's nice sharing the word of God, it's nice working for God, I enjoy it. But the good part, the place where the meat is being at his feet. That's the wonderful part. That's the part that nobody should take away from me. That's the most enjoyable part. That's the one that I like most. That's the nice. That's what Moses said, Lord, show me your glory. God said, I'll make my goodness. Because the presence of God has a goodness in it. That's why you keep going to church off and on. You come for 3 months, then you go, and the shepherd will bring you back. Then you come for 3 months, then you go, the shepherd. That's because you don't have the good part. I had fainted, lest I had believed to see goodness. The goodness of God in the land of the living. That's what David said. It's the goodness of God that keeps you from fainting, from giving up. It's good. What is the good part? And finally, Jesus said, being at his feet is the part that nobody can take away from you. You can take my job. You can take my money. You can take my clothes. You can take whatever you want. But what you can't take away, you can't take it. He said, Mary has chosen what nobody can take away from her. Nobody can take it away from her. Nobody can rip it. Nobody can take a decision and remove that part from your life. It's the time when Jonah lost everything. Jonah lost his ministry, his life, and he was in the middle of the whale. Even in the whale, he was able to pray. Jonah chapter 2 verse 1. And Jonah cried out, verse 2. Out of the whale cried I, and the Lord heard me. Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly. Even in the whale. Verse 2. I prefer verse 2, the way he says it. Out of the belly of hell cried I. Oh, yes. Even there, you can't take it away from me. Everything else can go. It can change. Everything can change. Everything is in the power of men. By being at his feet. Take what you want away from me. Tomorrow morning, I'll be at his feet. Tomorrow morning, you can take the rest. You can't take that one away from me. When Paul and Silas lost everything and they were in prison, that part. That's why Jesus said, that's the one. Then they started to worship. They were in chains. You can take away the ability to move, but you can't take away being at Jesus' feet. You can't take it away. When Jesus was on the cross and they have taken even his clothes, his friends have left him. Everybody he has walked with has run away from him. And he's completely naked on the cross. Even he was able to say, he was still able to speak to heaven. And say, my God, we're still able to pray. I don't know what you are in right now and what you are going through, what has been taken away from you, what has been changed, but the part which cannot be taken away from you. People don't pray every day because they are busy like matter. And they don't realize that what you need is not a job. What you need is not a salary. What you need is somebody to pay your school fee. What you need is not a relationship. What you need is a contract. What you need is not that agreement. What you need is to be at Jesus' feet. You need it. You need it. Ah. Oh, it's the good part. The good part. The good part. Pray every day. Pray every day. Please sit down. I'm sorry. That's point one. We have three more. I think, I'm over time. Oh, mercy. Okay, we may have to close soon. Oh, Jesus. Number two. People don't pray every day because they don't have a private space in their homes to pray. You cannot pray without a private space. Matthew 6:5. You cannot pray if you don't have a private place to pray. It's just part of it. And if you live in one chamber and hall, chamber is which one? The room. Chamber is the PM. And then the hall is what? The sitting room. Asaso. So, you guys are correct. Is it correct? Okay. The chamber in the hall. If you are living in a chamber in the hall with your two cousins and your mother and your father and your auntie, there's no space to pray. But in the night, usually nobody is in the hall. So that's why praying in the night is the solution to all these prayers. In the night, no, you can't be busy. You're better to sleep. And everything closes down in the night. And you escape busyness. And the second one is that you want to be alone. Your garden, nobody's in your garden. It's empty. If you live in a compound house, that middle area where where they pound the fufu and the thing that they find, what's it called? Coal pot, God bless. No, what's under the coal pot? The thing, the Y that is holding the black one that we find. You're all lost, new children. That place is completely empty. And that's where you can be. because you need it. Why do you need it? Because Jesus said, when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites. They love to pray, standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Now, prayer in the secret place has nothing to do with what men can see. Every time you have seen me praying, I wasn't praying in the secret place. If you see it, it's not. Number two, it can't be in church. He says, don't pray standing in the synagogue. Take me back. Don't pray standing in the synagogue. If you pray standing, he said, that's not the prayer that Jesus is talking about. He's talking about the one that's not in church, the one that nobody can see. He's giving instructions on the secret place. Okay? Then in the next verse, he says, when you pray, enter into thy closet. Thy what? A closet. And do what? Close the door. Shut it. Close the door. It means, number one, no one can see you. Number two, no one can reach you. To close the door is to disable WhatsApp. Because if someone can WhatsApp you, the door is not closed. If somebody can call you, the door is not closed. If somebody can see you and reach you, then the door is not closed. Jesus said, you need a place called a closet where you can be. It's private. Like, this is where I wait on God. Most people here can't even afford that. Most of us, we are children. We are in somebody's house. Or we are renting one room and other people. It's a complex. How many of you agree that it's a complex arrangement to find a place to pray? Good. But at 2 a.m., I guarantee you, those who are going clubbing, they've left. Those who are drunk, they close by 3 and they come and collapse in the house. So between 2 and 3, prayer can begin. In private. In private. You have to be alone. This is the good part. This is the good. You don't have it. You're a film star. You don't have it. You don't have what I'm describing. You stay the same. You don't change. Nothing changes in your life. That's why, for those of you who flow, you know about the glory of Lebanon. Ask your friend, do you know the glory of Lebanon? Ask your friend, do you know? And get an answer. Are you aware? How many of you, your neighbor looks confused about the glory of Lebanon? How many of you? Yes. The glory of Lebanon, Hosea 14 verse 6 talks about the smell of Lebanon. Lebanon smells of cedar trees. And it's a smell that is in Lebanon. Okay? So it talks about his smell as Lebanon. Lebanon has a smell. Okay? And it's called the glory of Lebanon. That smell. Okay? Then in Isaiah 35 verse 1, it says, the deserts and the solitary places shall be glad for them. Okay? And the desert shall rejoice and become and blossom as the rose. Okay? The wilderness and the solitary place. That's the place of prayer. Okay? And then the wilderness, the place of waiting on God. And says, you'll be glad for them. Verse 2, and shall blossom. And the glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it. So the smell that comes on people who have come from the place of prayer. There's a smell. It's something you can't put your hand on. A smell is something you can't even easily describe. There are some things, it's like if somebody sprays perfume, you say, what does it smell like? Some people can, but very few people, this is lilac, this is, I don't even know that. Vanilla, sandalwood. Hey, like wood for sandals or something else. Wow, sandalwood. These are smells, I don't know about it. So we wouldn't know. So when somebody comes from a private place with the Lord, there's a glory. There's a smell. That's why I say, if you don't pray, you don't change. Even Jesus couldn't change without praying. Luke 9:29, as he prayed, the fashion of his countenance was altered. Yes. Jesus, is your countenance the same? Do verses excite you? This type of things really excite me. As he prayed, how are you? Look, me, I used to be an angry man. Yes, I used to. Recently, I found my diary, my God, with an A. Angry. No, not H, that would be. Yes, I understand. Sometimes I have to help. Angry. Yes, I used to get so angry. One day I got so angry. I don't even remember what the issue was. I got so angry at all. And I punched the light switch in my house. And my hand went through into the socket. And all the pieces of plastic all over into my hand, bleeding like that. If I bring that attitude here. Hey, well, by now, I'll be in jail. Somebody will be in the grave. These are the only options. In this church, it's not work. How do you change? How is your countenance altered, edited? As he was praying. It happens as you pray. It happens as you pray. I see somebody here's countenance. Yourself is being changed. You know, the Holy Spirit is really here. He's falling on you and calling you to pray. To change yourself. How many of you want something to finally change? something to, how many of you have been trying to see something that will change in your life? It happens as he was praying, not when he prayed for 1 week or when he prayed some one Friday or he had some one. I'm talking about daily as he was praying. His countenance was altered. And I prophesy to you, your countenance, your character, your personality, everything in you that is funny and evil is being changed as you are praying. As you are praying. Alone. 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 Number three. Number three. Are you blessed or you're not? My time is far, far spent. Yeah. Okay, number three. People don't pray every day because other people who need them for something during the day continuously interrupt them. One day, text him. One day I was praying in my house, maybe before I married. I was at home in my room. I was praying. I share a room with my brother, so I wanted to pray. So I went to my little sister's room, who I can bully, and I told her, leave the room, I'm praying here. And she doesn't really care much about it. She said, okay, and then she left. So I put my projector up and I was listening to a message on the anointing. And I was praying. And you know, sometimes you enter into a certain realm when you pray. Yeah. So I was in a realm praying. Then my brother and my other sister came. Hey, Charlie is looking for anointing. hey, anoint me. Then my sister said, I receive it. Hey. I'm looking for anointing, Charlie. Let's pray. They started speaking in some tongues. Let's pray. That was the end of my prayer time. Has it happened to you before? Maybe you were worshiping and somebody just opened the door. Oh, sorry. I just wanted to take. Can I take my charger? I'm just taking my charger. Am I the only one? Has it happened to you before? Yes. We are constantly interrupting what you are trying to do. Can you hold the baby? Can you hold, just hold the baby for a short time? Just take the just like you be praying. So we are calling out to you. Sorry. Just hold, take the baby. Just the food is ready. The food is ready. I'm just telling you, the food is ready. Is it not real? Oh, Charlie, help me to preach. Is it not a real thing I'm describing? That's why people don't. Let me go to this side. Maybe I've not preached there for some time. Oh, let's be serious. Let's be serious. Let's maintain some seriousness. Yes. Hey, has it happened to you before? Do you want tea? And you know, I don't know why they whisper with sound like, do you want tea? Yeah, sign language like, okay. I'm going. I'm going. That's why people don't pray. Yes. I'll go. Do you have the key? Help me, Jesus. Genesis 32:22. Genesis 32:22. Okay, I'm reading. Is she helping or not? Good. And he rose up that night and took his... You have only one wife. And you say you can't pray. You have only one wife. The solution to those who interrupt you is praying in the night. Because in the night, everybody is asleep and they don't come and interrupt you. So Jacob took two of his wives. How many wives do you have? Some of you only have two girlfriends and you can't pray. See, the A was at the back. Yeah. He took his two wives and his two woman servants. That's the house help. Then 11 children. Can you just watch them? I'm just going to buy some. Just watch them. I'm drying the things at the back. I have to hang some clothes. So you just look at them. That's why you don't have to pray in the day. Now look. And passed over the ford Jabbok. That word Jabbok means empty. He emptied himself by sending everybody away. Wonderful. Then he said, next word. He took them and sent them over the brook and sent over what he had. Next verse, 24. And Jacob was left alone. Look at it. He was left what? And wrestled a man with him until it was evening. So he wrestled in the night until the breaking of day. The night in the evening, you'll be left alone. I'm telling you why you don't pray. You don't pray because you don't pray in the night. My brother, are you sleeping because you pray in the day? Ah, just check it. Don't worry. Nobody knows. Don't worry. It's fine. Just check it. Maybe because he was up at night. Now, Jacob is my friend. That's why I can do that. Jacob was left alone and he wrestled with a man until the breaking of day. The evening, everybody closes in the evening. Everybody stops in the evening. They are too tired. They'll leave you alone. If you want to pray every day, you got to pray in the evening. Sometimes my life becomes such that I have to pray in the middle of the night and come back and sleep. In the evening, maybe the only way, sometimes. Everybody will leave you alone. Nobody wants to chat at 3 a.m. No, nobody's online at 2:30. Matthew 14:23. We're almost done. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was alone. You will be alone when the evening comes. I said, when the evening comes, you'll be alone. You know, I'm having this vision as I'm preaching. I'm having a kind of vision of a lot of first lovers. Some are in a compound house. Some are upstairs in a flat. Some are walking in a garden. Some are in the sitting room. But all of them have lifted up their hands. And it's very dark. It's very dark. It's supernatural. God is sending on you the spirit of grace and supplication. You will call on him, you will pray. Hey, the church is going to become a church of prayer. This year, if we don't do anything, we'll be known for prayer. We'll be known for praying. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Finally, people do not pray because they do not have a good atmosphere for praying during the day. They don't have what? A good atmosphere for praying in the day. But in the night, there's an atmosphere. This is my last point for today. There's treasure in darkness. Night gives too much light. Isaiah 45 verse 3 says, I will give you the treasures of darkness and the hidden riches of secret places. Treasures. There's some things that only happen when it's dark. There are treasures in darkness. Sometimes, most of the time, when I'm going to pray, I go and bath first. And the light is off because I need darkness to access a certain treasure that at 7 a.m. is not available. Psalm 42 verse 8. This is my last verse for today. Psalm 42 verse 8. The Lord will command his loving. That word loving kindness is kindness, mercy, goodness. He will command that goodness, that presence to be with you in the day. Why? Because in the night, your day is blessed when your night is spent with God. Because in the night, songs hit differently in the evening. I'm telling you, oh yes. Even at our Saturday night service, sometimes the darkness, I will give you treasures in darkness. When you wake up in the night, at 1 a.m. and there's darkness, his song will be with me in the night and my prayer unto the God of my life. When you lift up, you have to learn, every first lover must have a Bluetooth speaker. It's basic setup. You have to learn to lift hands in the middle of the night. See? Waiting on you, patiently waiting on you. Alone. I ain't worried about the time, 'cause Lord, I seem to fight my strength while I'm waiting. Oh, somebody, you feel the Holy Spirit calling you to pray. I feel it. I'm waiting. I finished preaching, by the way. I'm waiting on you. Waiting on you. I'm patiently, patiently waiting. I'm waiting on you. I'm not worried about the time. Tell God, I seem to find my strength. I seem to get a little stronger. I seem to be able to overcome depression and sadness and hopelessness. I seem to be able to overcome my weakness. I seem to overcome my foolishness. I seem to gain something more when I wait on you. I'm not worried about the time. In the night, sometimes I sing, I love your voice. Of your voice, Lord.
In darkest nights, you were close like no other.
I've known you.
I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend.
I have lived.
And I have lived in the goodness of God.
I love you, Lord, because of your mercy.
Your mercy never fails.
I'm talking about at 2 a.m. Lift your hands, lift your hands. This is you at 2 a.m. Lift your hands. The prophetic vision of you at 2 a.m. Alone in your room. Alone with the Lord. From the moment I wake up.
From the moment I lifted up my head.
Until I lay on my head.
Oh, I will sing of the goodness.
Was left alone with every breath that I am made. And I was singing, Father of light,
draw me closer.
This morning I was alone with the Lord. This is what I was singing. Lord,
my eyes set on you.
Let me run the race of time.
Let me run the race of time.
With your life unfolding mine.
With your life unfolding mine.
And let the peace of God.
And let the peace of God. Let it rain.
Oh, Holy Spirit. Says we minister to the Lord. Deuteronomy 10:8. He separated the Levites to minister to the Lord every morning. The other song I was singing today was You hold my every morning. You calm my raging sea. You walk with me through fire. And you heal all my diseases. And then I told the Lord, you weren't there, it was me and him, but I told him, I trust. For me, you're my portion. You're what I got. You're what I got, Lord. You're more than enough. You're more than enough. You're more than enough. You're everything I need. I don't have everything here on earth. Not everything is all together, but you're more than enough. Jesus. Nothing he cannot do. I trust in you, Lord. I trust in you. I trust in you. Impossible. You hold my hand. And then, when I came to church today, I heard a song which I can't wait for tomorrow morning. Because tomorrow, that's the song I'm going to start with. And that's the song that we sang. I'll sing your praises. Forever. I'm talking about alone. I'm not talking about with your friend. I'm talking about a group prayer meeting. I'm talking about alone, just you. Here in your courts when I'm close.
Here in your courts where I'm close to your throne.
I find where I belong.
I found where I belong.
Lift your hands one last time. I'll sing your praises forever. Holy Spirit, fall on us now.
I'll sing your praises forever.
Lift your hands. The Holy Spirit is falling on you. He's calling you to prayer. The Spirit of grace and supplication. For we know not how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit itself helps our infirmity with moanings and groanings which cannot be uttered. The Holy Spirit is calling you to prayer.
To your
pour upon Mount Zion the spirit of grace and supplication, that they shall call upon me whom they have pierced. They will call on me whom they have pierced. It's the spirit of grace and supplication. It helps us to pray. It's falling on you now. Lift your hands and receive the spirit of grace and the spirit of supplication right now. Wherever you're standing, receive it right now. It's flowing. It's flowing. I sing your praises. The Holy Spirit is moving. He's touching your heart. He's touching your heart all over this place. He's touching you. Yes, yes, that's the Spirit. Yes. He's flowing. He's a person. He's walking amongst us. And he's touching some people. He's calling them to prayer. He's touching their hearts. He's taking away brutishness. He's taking away dryness. And he's calling them to the place of secret prayer. For he that abideth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty. He's touching you. He's touching. It's real. He's walking amongst us, placing his hand on your head, placing his hand on your heart. He's touching you. Yes, Lord. Lord, we thank you.
Deeper in love with you.
Oh, I love this part. Here in your courts, when I'm close.
Here in your courts, where I'm close to your throne. I find where I belong.
Thank you, Jesus. Receive the Spirit of grace and supplication. Whoever struggled to pray, whomsoever needs the help of the Spirit to know him in the secret place, right now receive that grace, that supplication, that assistance from the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you for your blessing over us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed.
I find where I belong.
The Bible says when the Holy Spirit comes, he'll convict us of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. If you're here today and in the presence of God, you can sense that you need Jesus. You can sense that your sins are going to destroy you. You can sense that you're far away from him, and you know that you need him, and you need to give your heart to him. Just lift up your right hand where you're standing. I know the Lord wants to save you. I know the Holy Spirit is walking amongst us. He's touching you. And if you feel, I need God. I need the Holy Spirit to turn my life around. I want you to come right here to me. I want to pray with you. If you lifted up your hand, just come. You want to join them. Maybe you didn't lift your hand. You want to join them. Just allow the Holy Spirit to lead you. We're in the presence of God. Maybe as I've been preaching, as we've been going through the whole service from the prayer time till now, whenever you can feel, I need God in my life. I'm too far away from him, and I want to give my heart to him. Maybe you've been in church for years, but today is a real day. Maybe you've even done it before, but today is the real day. Let the Holy Spirit lead you and let him bring you. I'm waiting for you. Come all the way. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my sister. You need Jesus Christ. Come, come. He's waiting for you. I'll sing your praises. There are many of you here. Let the Holy Spirit lead you. Just leave your seat and come. I need God. I need God. Chris, I go to church, but I need God. I feel it in my heart. I need God. I need him. I need him. Pray with me, Pastor. Please help me. I don't know what to do, but you pray with me. Come. The Holy Spirit will change your life. Jesus will change your life. Jesus will save you. Just leave your seats and come. There are many, 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 many more of you. Come all the way. God wants to change your life. God wants to touch your life.
To your throne, I find where
come all the way.
So we're calling out to you.
Come all the way.
Crying out to you. Forgive us of our sins in the name.
Come on, put the words up. As we seek your holy face.
As we seek.
We're waiting for you. Come. Come all the way. I'm waiting for you. Come, 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 come. Waiting for you. Quickly, quickly, quickly. I'm about to pray. It's not too late, but it's almost too late. I'm about to pray. Let the Holy Spirit lead you. You know yourself as you are here. You know I need God. I need him. I'm far away from him. I need him in my life. Pastor, pray with me. Pastor, help me. Just leave your seat and come. Don't fight with the Lord. Just come. I'm waiting for you. I need to give my heart to Jesus. Come. The Holy Spirit himself is convicting you of sin, of righteousness and judgment. Allow him. Put yourself to the Holy Ghost and come. I'm about to pray. 3 more seconds. I'm about to pray. My sister, my brother, come quickly. I'm waiting for you. I'm about to pray. When we finish singing this stanza, I'm done. I'm waiting for you. Come now. As we seek your holy face.
As we seek your holy face.
Turn from all.
Now, as we pray,
from heaven even now. Bow your heads, ladies and gentlemen. Those of you in front, bow your heads as well. I want you to repeat this prayer after me. And everybody in this church, let's pray together from the bottom of your heart. Say, dear Lord Jesus. Come on, let me hear you. Everybody, dear Lord Jesus, I come to you today just as I am. I'm a sinner. Forgive me. Have mercy on me. Wash me in your blood. Write my name in the book of life so that one day I come to heaven to be with you. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. In His name I pray. Amen.